All right, I think Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to all. Okay, and selamat pagi dan salam sejahtera. First of all, thank you very much for Prof. Nara, Prof. Roger Harris and all the organizing team of EBKF. You know, in this round is actually EBKF 8-021 and we are able actually to join, yeah. And I would like to actually congratulate and also to say thank you very much to Prof. Nara for actually thinking about integrating you know, the important part about water, especially for public education and awareness. Yeah. So this is actually where I come in and, you know, as part of UNIMAS, actually also the UNESCO IHP Malaysia, you know, partners, you know, part of the agencies. We are actually committed, yeah, to support on the, especially on the SDG 6, yeah, about the what you call this sustainable, related to sustainable water. So for this workshop, you know, I'm going to just, you know, start with the introduction, yeah. So just to give some basics. So I'm going to share my slide while going through. And of course, kita ada menjemput, yeah, ketua-ketua community. Dan kita ada daripada pelbagai yang melalui jemputan kita. So I will use mixed language. I think the same also like our panel speaker today. So we have to actually you know, accommodate because we are actually coming in as part of the doing on the public education. So I see yeah, a few of our speakers is actually here. Okay, in this case, I would like to share my screen. Okay, okay, let me just, can I actually share screen now? Okay, all right. Okay, can you see my screen, Prof. Nara? Is the screen clear?
Yes.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much. All right. I mean, it's also good to have some extra time, like Prof. Nara said. Yeah, we're supposed to schedule a 10:50, but this is actually great for us. Yeah, because we have quite a very, you know, useful and also to, it's not that easy to put in, for example, the pengarah from you know, bahagian pengurusan yang juga merangkap secara kehormat. Yeah, Insinyur Haja Bibi Zarina. Okay, from UNESCO IHP Malaysia. As a setiausaha dan juga now as a director for bahagian pengurusan, you know, sumber air dan hidrologi JPS. And we also have the second panelist that also actually Prof. Dr. Napsiah, yeah, very close to us, yeah. So the, one of the scientists, the top scientist about water, yeah, daripada USM, yaitu Prof. Mael, yeah, is actually one of our close colleagues that actually passed away. I think the time that we share a lot of sadness, yeah. And then Prof. Napsiah also actually pengerusi Jawatankuasa Pendidikan, Latihan dan Penerangan Awam Hidrologi, UNESCO IHP Malaysia. And then through this Jawatankuasa, because UNESCO IHP Malaysia is actually a very big, you know, structure. And of course, we work closely under the, you know, for UNIMAS, we are attached under the, you know, JKPLPA. Later on, Prof. Napsiah going to just, you know, sharing in terms of drawing from our experience about what we have actually done, yeah, and also actually part of raising the importance about water, yeah. And then we also actually privileged, yeah, to have Dr. Rosmina, who is now actually the director from Water Research Center from Faculty of Engineering, University of Malaysia Sarawak. So let me introduce myself first. I'm Dr. Rohaya. So currently I'm taking care of the portfolio as the director of UNIMAS Leadership Center. And I've been actually working with the UNESCO IHP Malaysia as part of the person in charge, yeah, in the programs that actually funded by UNESCO IHP Malaysia. We have two programs that we actually getting a grant, yeah, from UNESCO IHP Malaysia and it's still running. And then there's a one grant also that actually coming under our SWIFT, yeah, also related to water. Then part of our, we collaborate with the UNESCO IHP is actually funded under the National Commission for UNESCO, yeah, Suruhanjaya Kebangsaan UNESCO Malaysia. So the purpose of this workshop is actually to focus on giving some introduction. Okay, since this is actually virtual, when we run you know, workshop, we go on the ground. Yeah. So I'm going to just brief through just a bit. Yeah. This is actually later on you'll see all the panels. So actually the rural community, you know, Borneo of course are part of what we're doing, UNIMAS doing in participating, but throughout Malaysia. So we have a lot of programs, yeah. These are actually some of the programs that we start, yeah, in 2015. I think later on you will see more stories, yeah, from our pengurusi. And then I met also, you know, Councillor John Terawey. I mean, also during our trips, yeah, went to the barrio. So it's actually a very, very special project for us, yeah. And this is also the time that we're taking care on the part of how we can actually design a very, very effectiveness you know, model that we think, you know, that actually for the rural communities, for the young children, we running the young children part of the school focus, it has to be ya, perlu ada satu pendekatan yang special ya, yang design khas ya untuk you know, a community, terutamanya community luar bandar. Okay, so these are the part that this you know, session actually going to introduce. So one of the thing also part of the one who actually what you call become the program chairman of this project, yeah, funded by UNESCO IHP, we go into the ground, yeah, then we actually study, yeah, how actually the community process information as part of the effectiveness on raising what you call this campaign, yeah, so on the sustainable water. So we use a lot of methods, yeah. So these are actually some wonderful in our collection, yeah. Hopefully we can actually wrap up and we want to compile it, yeah, as part of also for our learning purposes. So whatever actually we run with the community is actually bringing the strong impact, yeah. So I was actually with KK and also with Penghulu, you know, so it's actually really, really wonderful. And one of the things that I can recall that time, we have to change a bit, this is the nature of the community. At that particular day, I was advised actually to go into this particular day where there is actually the energy, ambil apa ni, bayar apa what you call this electric, yeah. So I thought that that's actually a good idea. When they're there, then there'll be a lot of crowd. Yes, and it is actually very successful. They also actually can watch you know, a lot of activities going on, yeah. So we have these are actually the part that we done, yeah. So I think Barrio is actually a very, very special place. And then we hope we can reach out to you know, another site, yeah, like Baram, like all a few places that we put in this you know, maybe this year and next year. Last year we can't because of the COVID-19, yeah. All right, I'm not going to show this one, but I'm going to just, you know, asking for the, to say hello to my panelists, just to make sure that they are there. Okay, let me just stop share first. All right, okay, Mr. Nasa, actually our coordinator, the most important guy for us, okay. So I guess, Insigno, Ir Haja belum lagi ya, belum habis lagi ya.
Ya, belum. Okay, dia ada di mahkamah.
Alright, okay. Dia kita biasalah. Jadi kita dah ada plan B ya. That's why saya ask, you know, NASA untuk ni. Dan saya akan run video first, okay, sebagai Insigno, our panelist pertama. Okay, so I will run the video and then we will watch the presentation, ya, yeah, from the UNESCO IHP Malaysia. So saya akan, you know, share the video, okay. Okay, let me just share. Just to make sure that I click the right one. Okay. Okay. Click on the screen first.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih Puan Moderator. Yang berbahagia, Profesor. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Okay, just give me a few minutes, ya. Yeah? I have two big screen here. Okay. Okay, this one should do well.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih Puan Moderator. Yang berbahagia, Profesor Dr. Nafsiah Abdul Wahid, Pengerusi Jawatankuasa Pendidikan Latihan dan Perangan Awam, Hadroji Antarabangsa Malaysia UNESCO ataupun UNESCO IHP Malaysia, Graduate School of Business, University Sains Malaysia. Yang berbahagia, Dr. Rusmina Bustani, Director Water Research Center University Malaysia Sarawak. Yang berusaha, Profesor Dr. Rohaya Muhammad Nur, Director UNIMAS Leadership Center, Program Chairman for Borneo Zone Sarawak for two projects funded under UNESCO IHP Malaysia and SWIFT project funded under Grand Malaysia National Commission for UNESCO, iaitu Suruhanjaya Kebangsaan UNESCO Malaysia ataupun SCOM. Dan kepada para peserta para peserta bengkel semua. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh dan selamat pagi. Saya mulakan pembentangan saya mengenai dengan sustainable water for rural communities ataupun air yang mampat untuk komuniti luar bandar, ya. Okay, sedikit sebanyak mengenai dengan UNESCO IHP Malaysia. Apa itu UNESCO? UNESCO ini kita banyak kali sebut dah UNESCO, tapi sebenarnya dia adalah dia stands for United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, di mana dia aim untuk nak promote world peace dan juga security melalui international cooperation, melalui pembelajaran dan juga arts dan juga sciences dan juga pembudayaan ataupun culture, ya. So that is UNESCO in short, ya, daripada perkataan panjang tadi, iaitu United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization. Dan untuk di Malaysia kita ada UNESCO di Malaysia, iaitu UNESCO IHP. Kita berkooperasi dengan beberapa agensi kerajaan lah, banyak, ya, mempunyai 40 di bawah 40 ministries dan juga department dan institution untuk pendidikan tinggi, ya, yang berkaitan dengan AI di Malaysia. So kita berkolaborasi di bawah UNESCO IHP dengan agensi-agensi ini untuk mengadakan program-program, ya. Dan program ini di-establish dalam tahun 1975 dan diketuai oleh GPS Malaysia lah, DID Malaysia ataupun GPS, ya. Dan fungsi utama komuniti ini adalah untuk kita buat koordinasi lah dari segi sekiranya ada investigation ataupun research dan juga maklumat-maklumat, kita mengumpul maklumat-maklumat mengenai kan hidrologi dan memberi nasihat kepada pihak kerajaan mengenai dengan sumber-sumber air, ya. Okay, so itu adalah apa yang kita buat di bawah UNESCO IHP Malaysia, ya. Dan objektif kita adalah untuk to represent Malaysia in all issues related to programs of IHP under UNESCO dan juga participate dengan actively di dalam program-program tersebut, ya. Dan yang keduanya adalah untuk kita promote dan kita coordinate research programs dan berkaitan dengan hidrologi dan juga water resources di dalam negara kita lah dan juga region mungkin dengan Asia dengan Southeast Asia apa semua sekali, ya. Dan juga untuk kita promote dan kita coordinate programs on education, training dan public information on hydrology and also water resources. Dan sedikit mengenai dengan kitaran air atau water facts, ya. Kita biasa tengoklah kitaran air ini di mana daripada air hujan, daripada awan turunnya air hujan dan air hujan akan mengalir ke dalam sungai, pergi ke laut dan ada air dan air ini akan ada evaporation, naik ke langit semula dan juga daripada pokok-pokok kita panggil evapotranspiration, ya. So kalau kita tengok kitaran air ini, air itu tidak hilang tetapi air itu sebenarnya transfer, convert, ya, daripada air hujan dia convert kepada wap untuk naik ke udara, kemudian dia mengalir ke dalam sungai. So air tak hilang, ya, ada juga air akan diserap ke dalam tanah. Jadi dia kalau kita ada equation 1 + 1 + 1 = 3, so dia pun macam itulah, maknanya air ini kita campur-campur dia tak akan hilang, dia akan ada di mana-mana di dalam bumi ini dan juga di udara, ya. So itulah sedikit mengenai dengan kitaran air, ya. Dan water education is more than teaching hydrology and water cycle. So kita tengok apa dia on the water education, ya. So water education ini kalau kita tengok yang pertama ini adalah kita tengok yang sebelah kanan dahulu, ya, iaitu water education should also reach out to media professionals so that they can communicate water issues accurately and also effectively, ya. So water education ni kita bukan bagi hanya kepada anak-anak di sekolah tetapi juga kepada semua masyarakat, ya, dan termasuklah juga kepada media-media supaya mereka dapat report perkara yang baik mengenai dengan perkara yang baik dan juga yang tepat mengenai dengan sumber air, ya. Dan seterusnya adalah the work will include community education and strategies to promote community-wide water conservation as well as enhance skill in local co-management on water resources, ya. Maknanya kita kena buat program dengan community. Inilah one of the program that we are doing bersama-sama dengan community. Kita memberi pengajaran, pembelajaran kepada pihak-pihak community untuk sama-sama memahami air itu, appreciate air itu, ya. Air ini sesuatu sumber yang sangat-sangat patut kita hargai dan kita kena jaga sumber air kita, ya. Dan seterusnya adalah effort to be made on all countries to make water a significant component of the education lah curriculum, ya. So maknanya kita masuk dalam education kita daripada kindergarten sehinggalah kepada sekolah rendah, sekolah menengah dan even kita di Malaysia ini bukan kita stop dekat sekolah menengah, kita pergi juga kepada higher education. Maknanya kita pergi juga pada universiti dengan aktiviti-aktiviti juga dijalankan bersama-sama pihak universiti higher education, ya. Seterusnya kita tengok the need to include advancing scientific knowledge through the training of scientists as well as increasing knowledge on water issues through courses aimed at water professional and decision makers. So ini lebih kepada lebih tinggi lagi lah ya. Kita pergi kepada scientific knowledge, kita pergi dengan kerja-kerja dengan universiti untuk kita pastikan ilmu mengenai dengan air itu dapat kita kita gunakan dan bukan sahaja diguna sebagai pembelajaran tetapi juga sebagai di dalam kerajaan macam mana kita nak menggunakan sumber-sumber air tersebut ya. Okey, dan seterusnya adalah water education must go beyond the teaching of hydrological sciences and be both multidisciplinary and also interdisciplinary. So water kita education ni air ni kita tak boleh cakap ini air ni hak saya saja. Air ini sebenarnya adalah hak semua orang ya. Jadi kita kena pastikan supaya semua orang terlibat bila kita buat mengenai dengan air ini ya. Water education at all levels need to be improved. If the challenges in SDG are to be met. Okay. So kita tahulah dalam SDG tu, kalau dalam SDG kita ada SDG 6 yang berkait rapat dengan air dan dalam tu dia sebut macam-macam lah pasal water quality, pasal IWRM, pasal IRBM, pasal dari segi tarifnya, dia pergi apa, macam-macam benda berkaitan dengan air ada di dalam SDG. Dan sekiranya kita hendak mendapat status yang tinggi yang baik dari segi SDG, so kita semua bekerjasama untuk kita pastikan kita melakukan yang terbaiknya untuk SDG ya. So itu on water education. Dan seterusnya kita tengok dari segi policy statement di bawah National Water Resources Policy 2012 ya. So dalam policy statement ini disebut the security and sustainability of water resources shall be made a national priority to ensure adequate and safe water for all through a sustainable use, conservation and effective management of water resources and enabled by a mechanism of shared partnership involving all stakeholders. Yeah. So maknanya kita nakkan air itu selamat, sustainable, mapan, boleh digunakan, kita conserve dan juga kita ada pengurusan air yang efektif untuk memastikan air ini boleh dikongsi oleh semua orang ya, untuk kepentingan semua stakeholder, semua pemegang taruh, semua orang pernah pakai, orang di bandar, orang di kampung, orang industri, di sekolah, semua nak pakai air kan. Jadi kita kena pastikan supaya kita dapat manage menguruskan air itu dengan baik untuk semua orang boleh pakai ya. So dan dia ada publication inilah ya dari segi untuk menerangkan policy statement ini ya. Dan kita tengok juga access to water resources and water security ya. Yang kita nak pastikan adalah air kita tu ada dan air kita tu adalah bersih dan air kita selamat untuk digunakan ya. Dan kita tahu bahawa sumber air kita ini boleh datang daripada, of course lah, kita datang daripada langit lah sumber air itu kan. Dan bila sampai ke bumi, kita letak dalam dam, kita storekan dia kat dam supaya kita boleh jaga dia dan kita boleh gunakan sewaktu musim kering. Kita boleh release air ke sungai dan juga kita ada tasik-tasik dan juga kolam-kolam untuk memastikan air-air hujan itu ditakung untuk kegunaan. Jadi tidaklah semua air itu turun dan semuanya akan alir ke laut habis. Jadi kita tak dapat nak guna air tersebut kan. Jadi kita akan takung di daratan melalui empangan, melalui kolam, ORS macam-macam disebut sekarang ni, taps ke, takungan air pinggir sungai dan ORS ni off river storage, lakes, dams, whatever semua sekali ya. So kita akan takung sebanyak mungkin untuk kegunaan kita di masa-masa yang kita suntuk air ni, mana masa musim kering, kita akan menggunakan air daripada kolam-kolam ini ya. Dan kita air ini akan dibawa kepada intake dan juga treatment untuk memastikan air yang kita guna itu adalah bersih dan selamat ya. Dan sebagaimana saya sebut tadi, air ini digunakan oleh pelbagai orang ya. Community, orang, industri, agricultural, orang nak buat pertanian pun menggunakan air. Dan yang penting sekali adalah environment kita sendiri juga memerlukan air ya. Maknanya persekitaran kita ini memerlukan air, pokok-pokok perlukan air, di hutan perlukan air. So kalau tak ada air ini kering, gersang semuanya kan. So that sangat penting air ini kepada kita, kepada manusia ya. Dan kita tengok dari segi water security, apa yang dikatakan water security itu ya. So kalau ikutkan dalam kotak yang berwarna biru ini, water security ini disebut sebagai the capacity of a population to safeguard sustainable access to adequate quantities of acceptable quality water for sustaining livelihoods, human well-being and socio-economic development, for ensuring protection against waterborne pollution and water-related disasters, and for preserving ecosystem in a climate of peace and political security. So the big words yang disebut di sini ni semuanya diterangkan dalam gambar ini ya. So gambar ini menerangkan apa itu yang dimaksudkan water security. So apa yang kita nak tu adalah ada air yang mencukupi. So kita pasang tap tu ada aja air keluar ya. So kita nak pastikan air sentiasa ada ya. Dan juga kita boleh minum air itu. So sekarang ini mungkin kita tidak sampailah kepada tahap kita buka pipe, kita buka pipe dan kita boleh terus minum air daripada pipe ya. Sebab di negara-negara maju dia buka pipe dia terus minum. Negara kita, kita kena buka pipe dan kita kena boil, kita kena masak dulu air itu sebelum kita boleh minum. Tapi air itu sudah pun bersih untuk kita membasuh, membasuh sayuran, basuh buah-buahan. Tapi dia untuk kita memastikan dia sebagai air minuman, kita perlu rebus air itu ataupun masak air itu supaya kita pastikan air yang kita minum itu adalah selamat ya. Dan dia adalah untuk livelihood lah untuk kita semua, untuk kegunaan kita semua dan untuk kesejahteraan kita, human well-being ya, dan juga untuk pembangunan negara ya. So itu inilah apa yang disebutkan dalam perkataan yang banyak-banyak ni, inilah yang disebutkan. Dan dia juga adalah untuk memastikan kita protect daripada waterborne pollution. Maknanya air yang digunakan oleh industri, pastikan dia tidak mencemarkan sungai. Ini ada isu sekarang ini ya. So kita kena pastikan bahawa air daripada industri-industri disalurkan dengan bersih ya. Dan juga kita tidak ada water related disasters, contohnya banjir dan juga pencemaran air disebabkan penyakit melalui air, bawaan air. Dan kita dan kalau water related disaster macam banjir itu di musim terkujuh ini kita tidak boleh elak ya, sebab perkara ini berlaku. Tapi kita nak pastikan sekiranya ia berlaku, kita semua selamat. Maknanya banjir mungkin berlaku tetapi bukanlah banjir sehingga menyebabkan ratusan orang meninggal ya. Kita pastikan selamat. Dan negara kita setakat ini sebagai rekod kita, saya rasa yang paling tinggi yang setakat setahu saya lah, oleh banjir 2014 di mana 25 orang yang meninggal ya. So kita tidak seperti negara-negara luar ya, di mana kalau dia banjir tu matinya ratusan orang yang mati ya. So kita sekarang ini yang paling tinggi kita ada adalah 25 orang sahaja ya. Dan dan kita nak pastikan juga untuk ekosistem lah, sebagaimana saya sebut tadi untuk environment. Maknanya air itu digunakan untuk environment. So tidak gersang lah bumi kita ini. Ada tempat-tempat yang hijau yang boleh kita pergi ya untuk rekreasi apa semua sekali, ada airnya ya. So itulah dia, dan kita pastikan supaya tidak bergaduh lah. Kita di peace ya, peace. Di region kita ini kita tidak bergaduh mengenai air ya, sebab kita alhamdulillah lah, sebab negara di Asia Tenggara dan juga di Malaysia ini kita punya air yang banyak. So kita tidak bergaduh. Tak seperti mungkin negara Afrika, negara apa semua, mereka fight for water. So dia bergaduh mengenai air ini kan. So kita alhamdulillah kita peaceful lah kat sini ya, dan juga political stability lah untuk pastikan tidak ada pergaduhan di antara negara mengenai dengan air ini ya. So itu adalah dari segi water security ya. Dan kita tengok way forward. Way forward ni macam mana ya? So kalau kita tengok, kalau di JPS lah, apa yang kami nak bawa adalah water resources infrastructure strategies kami. Kami ada empat perkara yang nak kami tekankan di sini, iaitu kita nak building with nature. Maknanya kita tidak mahulah pergi meroboh benda daripada nature tu. Kita nak pergi habis concrete line everything semua sekali. We try not to ya. We try to shift sekarang ni our mindset lah, daripada dulu kita banyak concrete line everything. So sekarang kita nak go with nature, building with nature ya. Dan kita nak make room for water. So kalau tengok gambar ni lah, gambar sebelah ni, make room for water. Sungai itu dia ada ruang dia untuk dia nak membesar sekiranya hujan berlaku ya. Itu dia nak expand. Sungai itu dia boleh expand apabila hujan berlaku. That's why kita panggil flood plains. Dia ada di tepi sungai itu, reserve dia dan juga flood plain, di mana untuk air itu mengalir apabila hujan lebat turun. Jadi kita sekarang ni pantang tengok tanah yang lapang, semua kita nak bagi bina bangunan. Kita nak bina rumah, nak bina apa, dari di tepi-tepi sungai. Dan apabila banjir berlaku, kita pun terdedah dengan banjir. Dan kita pula komplain. So itulah dia. Sebenarnya Tuhan dah jadikan muka bumi kita ini dah cantik dah. Ada sungai, ada ruang untuk sungai itu berkembang sekiranya hujan lebat, mana air boleh overflow daripada sungai, spread kepada tempat-tempat yang kandah-kandah. Tapi kita ni rasa kita lebih cerdik lagi, kita pergi tutup semua kawasan-kawasan yang kandah-kandah tu, kita pergi tambunnya dan kita bina serapat-rapat dengan sungai. Mengakibatkan apabila banjir, kita lah terdedah kepada water related disasters ini ya. So what we want is to we make room for water. Kita bagi dia spread ya. Kemudian bringing back the beaches. Yang ni apabila kita pergi ke pantai pun kita nak pastikan supaya pantai-pantai kita terpelihara. dan juga creating for resilience. Maknanya kita nak create resilient, maknanya kita ada infrastruktur resilient. Kita nak pasti manusia, kita sendiri pun ada resilient terhadap disaster sekiranya berlaku. Ya. Jadi bukanlah kita ni sekiranya berlaku disaster, kita dah tak tahu kita kapan dah nak buat apa. So kita pun mesti bersedia. Sekiranya orang kata apa, jika takut macam mana, jangan di tepian pantai ya. Kalau takut kepada ombak, something like that. Saya tak pernah ingat ya. Apa ni, maknanya kita kena be resilient. Jadi kita duduk tepi sungai, kita kena tahu banjir akan berlaku. You kena pandai-pandailah berhadapan dengan situasi sekiranya berlaku bencana ya. Okay. Dan seterusnya adalah untuk kita nak memperbaharui lah undang-undang mengenai air. So undang-undang air kita ni semuanya sangat-sangat lama ya, 1932 apa daripada zaman-zaman dulu, dan belum ada review yang dibuat yang terkini. So ini yang kita nak buatkan ya. Kemudian tarif setting mechanism. Yang ni kalau ikutkan kita ni antara negara yang termurah lah kita bayar air tarif kita ni. Jadi sedang dipikirkan untuk kita menaikkan tarif air supaya apa? Supaya tarif air ini bila dikutip akan kita boleh guna balik untuk kita improve water infrastructure kita sendiri ya. Jadi bukanlah untuk bila kata tarif naik ni kita kata kerajaan kutip duit, kerajaan kutip duit supaya dia boleh memperbaiki sistem-sistem apa ni, saluran-saluran air, pipe-pipe air semua ini boleh diperbaharui dan mengurangkan kerosakan apa semua sekali ya. Dan seterusnya Integrated National Water Data Center. So ini kita nakkan sekarang ni banyak pada agensi-agensi kerajaan. Macam tadi earlier on I mentioned that we have about 40 ministries dan agencies yang water related ya. So kita ada banyak ya. So banyak banyak agensi, banyak data daripada semua agensi. Jadi data-data ini semua disimpan di kementerian, di jabatan, di agensi masing-masing dan tidak dikongsi. Dikongsi apabila dipohon ya. Jadi kita punya akses kepada data-data ini agak susah ya, limited. Jadi kalau kita ada integrated data National Water Data Center ini memudahkan kita untuk berkongsi data ya. Berkongsi data untuk kita memudahkan pembangunan dalam negara ya. Jadi ini JPS telah pun membangunkan, kita panggil SEMSA, iaitu sistem maklumat sumber air, yang mana kita telah pun memanggil beberapa banyak agensi-agensi kerajaan untuk berkongsi data melalui data center kami ini ya. So ini ada dalam proses, kita masih belum launch lagi, dah ada final stages already lah ini ya. Okay. Seterusnya kita tengok pula sekarang ni apakah aktiviti-aktiviti yang telah pun dilaksanakan daripada IHP untuk to support rural communities ya. Apa yang telah kita laksanakan sebelum ini ya. So kalau kita tengok yang ini, kita ada aktiviti pada tahun 2015 di mana kita telah pun menjalankan aktiviti di Borneo Zone, iaitu kita dah buat National Young Leaders Water Awareness Camp at UNIMAS, di UNIMAS ya, organised di bawah UNESCO IHP Malaysia pada Ogos 2015 dulu ya. Dan kita pun pernah buat National Young Leaders Water Awareness Camp di Sabah, juga diorganised oleh UNESCO IHP Malaysia dan Sabah Hydrology Department. Yang ini pun kita buat dalam tahun 2017 ya. Ini kita tengok history sikit lah aktiviti-aktiviti yang telah pun kita laksanakan ya. Dan seterusnya kita buat lagi pada 2019 kita buat community project sustainable water for Sarawak diverse and dispersed communities. Kita buat ni pada 2019 dengan di Bario community Sarawak ya. So kita pergi masuk sampai ke pedalaman untuk membuat aktiviti bersama dengan rural communities ya. So ini dalam 2019 ya. Kemudian seterusnya kita ada lagi satu community project sustainable water for Sarawak diverse and dispersed communities, kita buat di Kampung Buntal Santubong dan juga Borneo Travel Village Kampung Apar di Sungai Sarawak ya. So yang ni kita buat dalam 2018 ya. So setakat ini itu yang mampu kita buatlah daripada 2015, 2017, 2018, 2019. 2020 kita tak dapat nak buat disebabkan oleh COVID-19 dan 2021 pun kita tak dapat lagi nak buat aktiviti secara berdepan lah. Dan ini adalah salah satu aktiviti yang kita buatlah pada tahun ini untuk memberi kesedaran kepada rural communities ya, dan kita bergabung dengan UNIMAS ya untuk buat program ini. We are looking forward bila borders negara kita dibuka supaya kita boleh buat program bersama dengan komuniti. We would like to go to all bertemu dengan komuniti-komuniti ini untuk melaksanakan program. I think yang mana yang dah buat pada tahun-tahun lepas itu mereka sangat gembira dapat bersama-sama dengan pihak-pihak komuniti semua, ya. Okay, so untuk sebagai conclusion, saya mungkin saya boleh konklusikan kita kata di sini bahawa Malaysia ini memang sebagaimana saya sebut tadi, kita ni banyak hujan, ya. Kita ni ada banyak hujan di Malaysia, di Sabah dan Sarawak memang kita ada lebih kurang dalam 3000 mm setahun hujan, ya. So kalau nak compare dengan negara-negara lain, sikitlah, kita ni memang banyak, ya. Dan dan 95.7% daripada rakyat Malaysia sebenarnya sudah boleh akses kepada air yang bersih, ya. Dan 4.3% lagi ini masih lagi tidak dapat mencapai air bersih, lah, di kawasan-kawasan yang agak pedalaman, lah, dan juga di mungkin juga di pulau-pulau, ya, dan komuniti-komuniti kecil yang tak dapat ditembusi lagi, lah, ya. So sebenarnya 95.7% ini tinggi dah yang kita boleh capai, ya. Sudah ramai yang boleh buka paip dan minum, bukan minum, kita boleh terus buka paip di rumah dan air sudah ada, ya. Tak perlulah kita pergi ke sungai untuk nak bawa air daripada sungai untuk kita nak mandi, nak basuh apa semua sekali. Dan seterusnya, our primary water resource are coming from river and dams, ya. So kita punya primary water resource kita adalah daripada sungai dan juga daripada empangan-empangan. Jadi kita kena jagalah surrounding area kita itu, especially kalau rural communities ni, mereka duduk di kawasan pedalaman, di mana mereka boleh menjaga sumber air daripada hulu-hulu ni, ya. Sebab sungai ni berasal daripada hulu, tau, dari turun mari ke bandar semua sekali, kan. Jadi kita kena jaga, ya, sungai ini daripada pollution, dan juga yang pentingnya adalah pada uncontrolled development. Ini yang maknanya pembangunan-pembangunan yang tidak terkawal, pembukaan tanah yang luas tanpa kawalan, ya, itu membuatkan banyak sediment masuk ke dalam sungai. So kita tak nak perkara ini berlaku. Kita nak kurangkanlah benda ini. Tak boleh nak kata zero, tak boleh, sebab pembangunan berlaku, dan kita nak benda ni kita kata control development. Yang banyak berlaku ni uncontrolled development, yang tidak terkontrol, tidak terjaga, ya. Maknanya membuka tanah yang tidak ada best management practices-nya untuk control sediment daripada turun ke sungai-sungai. So ini yang kita nak jaga, nak pastikan supaya kita dapat kontrolnya. Dan seterusnya, dia kata we need to invest more on exploring alternative water resource such as groundwater, rainwater harvesting dan juga desalination of seawater. Setakat ini kita belum lagi tahap yang kita perlu perlu menggunakan alternative water, tetapi ada masa-masanya juga semasa musim kering. Kita ni tidak di Malaysia ini tidaklah kita melalui musim kemarau. Kita panggil kita water stress sahaja. Tidak langsunglah definasi kemarau lagi. Sehingga tahap water stress di mana kita ada sedikit kekangan dari segi sumber air. Jadi kita mencari alternatif water resources, ya. Kita buat rainwater harvesting. So rainwater harvesting ini di dalam perumahan-perumahan baru mungkin kita boleh masukkan elemen-elemen rainwater harvesting dan juga mencari sources-sources lain daripada sumber air groundwater, ya. Daripada dalam tanah kita banyak. Di Malaysia ini, negeri Kelantan bukan menggunakan dalam 65% daripada sumber airnya daripada groundwater. Dan mungkin di Sabah dan Sarawak banyak juga menggunakan groundwater. Saya tidak ada figurnya. Kita kena carilah ini alternatif, lah, sekiranya air daripada air surface water kita menghadapi masalah dan need alternative water, ya. Dan juga desalination of seawater. Kita belum lagi ke tahap desalination. Ada dah negara-negara yang perlu membuat desalination of seawater. That's why kita kena jagalah sumber air kita ini supaya kita tidak sehingga ke tahap seperti ini, ya. Sehingga kita kena ambil air masin dan kita kena keluarkan air dan kita kena tapis garamnya supaya menjadi air yang fresh water, ya, dan jadikan dia fresh water, ya. Yang mungkin yang sekarang yang boleh kita buat sebagaimana Singapura adalah kita menggunakan kita panggil downstream dam ataupun membuat empangan di muara-muara sungai, ya. Dan kita dam up water di bukan di hulu tapi sebenarnya di hilir sekarang ini, ya. So ini adalah keadaan baru, ya. Kita buat dam di hilir instead of buat dam di hulu, ya. So ini adalah keadaan-keadaan yang boleh diterokai, dikaji untuk pelaksanaan sekiranya kita terdesak, untuk menggunakan air sumber air sedia ada. So dengan itu saya ucapkan terima kasih, dan saya ada satu gambar Gunung Kinabalu yang cantik itu untuk tatapan semua. Sekian, terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum.
Hajah Bibi Zarina, and I think that's actually a very good introduction about what's actually we've been doing, been committed, and of course UNIMAS, and other what you call we have a number of UAs, working closely with the UNESCO IHP Malaysia and also SCUM into working with the schools, communities. So these are actually the agenda that we support. I read one comment from Dr. John Poh. Thank you very much, Dr. John. How many rural community have our project covered in Sarawak? I can talk from the Sarawak where actually coming under my, as a person in charge. So we actually, for the serious work that we go into the very remote area of the rural community is actually Bario. Okay, so we actually using Bario as our test bed, in the sense that, how do we can design a very, very effective campaign, that can go on the rural community. So that's actually done in 2019. So for the 2020 COVID coming, but the model actually pretty much, it's actually can be executed already as part of my work actually concern, with my team in UNIMAS that running for this kind of works. So and then we managed to get a grant from this year to execute about 4 location, that coming. Then we give focus on the empangan, so persekitaran di sekitar dams, So that's actually our focus to go into the rural community. So roughly, Dr. John, that's actually pretty much, just a beginning, to come in. And also we coming with a very special, ways of how we can say that we want it to be very effective, in terms of, measuring the impact of whatever program that we run to raise the awareness, So that's why ECT actually one of our strategic partners in this case, because ECT actually a widespread, So that's actually just a bit to highlight for Dr. John. All right, I'm going to pass the second panel, this session to the second panelist. Can I confirm that, yang berbahagia Prof. Dr. Nap Sia, Prof. Dr. Nap, are you there? Dr. Nap? All right.
I am here.
Okay, you tak ada kamera ke Dr. Nap? Tak dapat on?
Ya, ada sekejap.
All right, good. Okay, let's give Dr. Nap a few minutes, okay. So Dr. Nap, you're going to share your PowerPoint slide as well, right? Or you are just
want
to...
Yes, I am.
Okay, good. Okay, I think the technical team will allow you to actually to do the sharing. Okay, Dr. Nap, so if you're ready, okay, I pass this to you, yeah? All right, all the best, Dr. Nap. Thank you very much.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Very good morning to all. Thank you very much, Ayah. So sorry because kata ini nak buat santai, so therefore I am very, very santai. Okay. Hopefully everybody is okay with that. Okay. Anyway, I know Hajah Bibi is not here, but then again, I welcome her to be here. And then of course to Dr. Rosmina Bustami as the director of our Water Research Center, and of course our beloved moderator, my sister, my dearest sister, Dr. Ayah. In terms of that. Anyway, I have been asked to talk about this sustainable water for rural communities. But then again, I think from the video that Hajah Bibi has already shared, you know that she has covered lots of them. And in fact, many of them, so no need for me to actually cover. So basically, please bear with me. And then what we'll do is that we just sort of like talk about the challenges or what are the activities and so on that we have actually gone through with Dr. Ayah's projects, especially, okay, in terms of that. Okay, so now let me just go on to this. Hold on. Oh, by the way, you can actually call me. Other people usually call me just Kak Nap or Makcik Nap or even Dr. Nap or whatever it is, anything is okay with me. All right. So now let me just go quickly with this Jawatan Kuasa Pendidikan, Latihan dan Penerangan Awam. Now, it's a long name, but then isn't it shorten is JKPLPA, UNESCO IHP Malaysia. Every time I have to say this word, I usually stumble, because it's too long or something. But then in English, it is actually about education, training, and public awareness committee, UNESCO IHP Malaysia. Now, since Hajah has already talked to you about, has already shared with you about what UNESCO IHP is all about, so therefore, let me just go quickly to this one on our role. So now, basically, our role is huge. We are here to actually to educate, train, and promote public awareness to Malaysia's population. When you population, Malaysian population, we're talking about 32.7 million people in Malaysia. But then again, luckily we say, because we cannot make it, you know, we can't make it, there's no way, you know, it's impossible for us actually to make it. But then we have already sort of like targeted some community groups, which includes, you know, like farmers, fishermen, researchers, professionals, women, students, and also rural communities. Now, when you talk about rural communities, this is the group that Aya wants me to talk about. And then the thing is, when we do this, our responsibility lies with the fact that we have to follow the aspirations of UNESCO. You know, UNESCO, educational, scientific and cultural organization. So therefore, we have also to follow their lead, since we are under its umbrella. And of course, in line with SDG 6 as well, which is clean water and sanitation, there's lots of issues as Hajah has already spoken earlier. And also in terms of Malaysia's National Water Resources Policy, which is DESAN. Okay. And then I am in the working group number 5, because I hit this committee. So therefore, this is how we actually we go and identify these targeted community groups, and then this is also the reason for why we also, you know, we also understand that, you know, it's without help from everybody, you know, this cannot happen. At the moment, for information, although as I just says, we have more than 40 members. In fact, we're talking about 48 members altogether, but then only 38 are actually active members. And then, fortunately, these members actually come from various organizations and also institutions. So just let me give you an example. Nahrim is in our is with us, very active. PPJ is also with us. You know, these are the examples of the organizations. And then for the institutions, especially the higher learnings, USM, UKM, UTM, and then of course UNIMAS. You know, are these. But then the ones that I mentioned here are those that are the pioneer members that actually joined UNESCO IHP before. And then of course, this is the ones that I put in right here is because of the expected outcome. Wow, we are very ambitious. We are very ambitious. We know that we cannot do it, but then we still, you know, hope for the best. That is, we wanted to create communities change agents. We know that this one is difficult. We still wanted to go and create environmental stewards. We still wanted to see that there are initiators amongst us within the community. And of course, we wanted to make sure that we are leaders or anybody, you know, it doesn't matter from the women groups, students group, rural communities, farmers, fishermen, research professionals, it doesn't matter whatever it is, but then we want them to actually to lead on sustainable water. Because again, although Malaysia has lots of water, lots of rainfall, but then again, we have issues. The perception that people have regarding Malaysia does not have any water issues because we have lots of rainfall, that one is wrong. That one is just a myth. That's why it's just a myth. Okay, so that's the reason for why we say that the responsibility is very high on us. Now, basically, in all those things, this is what we want to see. We do not care, because in here, we can actually see in the left picture, we're talking about the river, you know, which is, you know, really ideal. And then at the same time, you know, in the right corner, we also have Masjid Jami, also very, very clean. This is the ideal situation that we want to see. So it means that everybody has to play their role. And then that everybody also includes us. Now, when we wanted to do to achieve such ideal situation like that, so these are the education and training that we do, because again, we must know that we are actually reaching out to communities with differences. So therefore, we have to make sure that the way how we do is through non-formal methods, informal methods, not formal methods. Because those formal methods are being taught in classrooms, are being taught in universities, are being taught in other institutions that already have done. But then in terms of us, we wanted to make sure that people are comfortable with us, and then, you know, you really come out with us, and then be with us. And then in terms of this, what I shared with you is only one module. Okay, this one is water matters. We are talking about the bioindicator module. This is where, you know, students and also participants, other community participants who came to our program, were brought to the river, and then we thought that, you know, there are petunjuk-petunjuk biology out there which you can actually use. You know, the micro invertebrates are there, yang mana kita boleh guna, so that we can actually tengok how to say water quality. And here, when we do this, we usually have modules, and then from our modules and so on. I'm just showing with you these are the modules that we have. That we have so far, that we have used. This one is the penentuan indeks kualiti air sungai menggunakan petunjuk biologi pendekatan pembelajaran melalui pengalaman. This one has this one is published under UNESCO IHP. This one is also the next one. This one is the second. No, this one is the third in the series, whereby the same one. This is the module that we use, but then this one is another module that we have actually done, or we have actually created, to make sure that people can actually do it, you know, using, jadikan ini sebagai satu aktiviti riadah keluarga. So it means that, you know, you can actually mempelajari menggunakan kaedah penganggaran kualiti air sungai dengan petunjuk biologi ini, tetapi dengan cara yang santai, whereby you can actually go and ask, bring your family members to the sungai, enjoy, and then at the same time you're also learning something, you know, out of that. And then you can actually say saying that, oh, I know what is the quality index of this river and so on. Okay, and then again, this one is all the outdoors that we can do. Now when we go into households, when we go back and so on, so this is also another module that we use. This one is for drinking water for society, practicing water saving at home. So again, when we talk about water saving or sustainable water, not necessarily that the practice are supposed to be outdoors. You know, usually everything starts at home. And then so this is among the modules that we have we have produced that talks about the tips, sharing the tips on how we can actually do those things. Okay, and here, this one, another book that we have actually done in terms of that. This one again, in the series of Drinking Water for Society, this one is about educating the public. So this is where all the IHP members actually join in, and then actually shared their experiences in organizing programs, you know, for communities that they are involved or they are responsible of. Okay, so that one is just what I shared. Let me just go on to the next one. So this one is again, you see, when we talk about the bioindicator module, we bring students, we bring the participants to the site. And then the method that we use is through experiential learning. So meaning that everybody go there, you know, and then they use their five senses. They can actually see, okay, whether the surrounding is okay or not okay. Is it too hot? Is it too cold? And then, you know, can you actually see a butterfly or firefly in there? It can, and then after that, can you actually smell the river? You know, is it very, very smelly, or, you know, is it very dirty, and so on. Those are the kind of things that we do. And then when we talk about bioindicator, for those who does not know, I'm just sharing with you in terms of this. Again, we are using these micro invertebrates, whereby we say that they can be used to help us know the quality of water that is there in the water in the river. Why we use them? We use these because of why? Because, you know, they are very, very sensitive to their surroundings. Kalau kata kita tak jaga dia orang, so on, dia orang senang sangat mati. So we say about experiential learning, we are also using one one model. This one is taken from social sciences, marketing especially. We use AIDA model. So this AIDA model is very, very simple, where we say attention, interest, desire, action. Very simple. So meaning that we make sure that we attract their attention, the participants' attention on what, on the issues that we wanted to bring, or on the modules that or the modules that we are sharing, so that we can actually create interest, and then after that desire, and last but not least, this one is the last part and very, very difficult to achieve. This one is about implementation, whether they are, you know, they are ready to become change agents, or they themselves, you know, wanted to change to the better and so on. So basically, as you can actually see earlier on, in terms of this, you see, we bring them to site, and then these are the rivers. You see, these are the rivers, and then we can actually see in terms of this, how the students were looking over the kanta and so on, untuk tengokkan dekat sini sama ada ataupun tidak binatang-binatang tersebut. Okay, so and then after that, in terms in untuk yang lain-lain pula, kita ada other modules as well. Contohnya kat sini kita boleh lihat tentang apa, kualiti air juga, tetapi menggunakan cara yang lain, menggunakan pH, kaedah pH dan sebagainya. Okey, yang dan kita belajar semua menggunakan SBC lah, kita gunakan environment yang ada. Jadi senang. And then of course, walaupun kita menggunakan kita punya kita punya function ataupun kita punya objective is actually about sustainable water to promote pengurusan air secara mampan dan sebagainya, tetapi one of another indirect hasil daripada apa yang kita ajarkan di sini adalah ini dia contoh. Oops, sorry about that. In terms of this, we wanted to create them so that mereka merasakan happy, student-student merasakan happy untuk jadi scientist later on. So sciences dan juga teknologi semuanya diajarkan di sini bersama, and so that they can become leaders on their own, and then they can actually go and lead other programs, tak kira lah program ini ataupun program-program yang lain. Now let me share with you the report card of JKPLPA UNESCO IHP Malaysia. Although as I just says that we started in Malaysia in 1975, but then for the training for JKPLPA, we actually started training the public in 1993. Lama dah kayaknya, 1993. But then at that particular time, we were targeting school children in Malaysia only, because again, as you know, untuk kita reach out to the communities on and so on, it costs money. It is very, very expensive. Particularly kalau nanti bila kita nak lihat tentang aktiviti yang di Sarawak contohnya, memang terlalu expensive because of again untuk pergi transport, untuk pergi ke kawasan-kawasan yang pedalaman dan sebagainya, very, very difficult. But then again, coming back to this, we started with bengkel pengurusan air mampan, then after that seminar pengurusan air mampan, then after that we rebranded the whole lot, then it becomes Water Watch program for young leaders, or WWP for YL, ataupun kita panggil di sini Camp Pemimpin Muda Prihatin Air. And then after that, kita dalam 2010 and so on, we expanded to other targeted communities, including the rural communities. And then this, I go di sini, okay, I share kat sini ada tentang Borneo. Borneo akan meliputi Sabah dan juga Sarawak, dan juga kita ada daripada Peninsula Malaysia yang meliputi all states. Dan kebanyakan daripada community yang kita targetkan, bukan sahaja Bumi Putra, tetapi juga tentang orang-orang asli, indigenous people, something like that. And di sini contohnya, kita dah letakkan di sini aktiviti-aktiviti yang telah dilakukan yang being led by UNIMAS. Okay, so let me just share with you again some something untuk yang ini. Walaupun sebenarnya macam saya katakan tadi, reaching out to rural communities has actually started in 1990s, tetapi yang kita betul-betul fokuskan, kita start focusing on the rural communities adalah daripada 2015. And then we were lucky because at that particular time, UNIMAS comes to us and then say, okay, we wanted to join. We wanted to join. And then we give them, we give the UNIMAS, the university, with this national, Water Watch for young leaders, a program for young leaders 2015. They started at UNIMAS, and then after that dia start lagi dengan program-program yang lain berdasarkan tentang berkaitan community project sustainable water for Sarawak diverse and dispersed communities. Okay, yang ni kata, tadi Hajah dah ceritakan tentang daripada 2017, 2018, 2019 and then after that you stop at 2020. Betul tak, ya kan? Cannot do much about that, yeah, about that. And then anyway, sebabnya di sini kalau kita lihat di sini, UNIMAS memang leader. And then we expect that UNIMAS akan lead terus di Borneo Zone, di Borneo Zone. But then this year, alhamdulillah, kita dah dapat membership daripada Universiti Sabah. Universiti Sabah Malaysia, Universiti Sabah Malaysia. So therefore kita boleh jangkakan bahawa program-program di Sabah kali ini mungkin akan mula diambil alih oleh universiti tersebut dan sebagainya. Okay. Sebenarnya saya just nak cerita sikit di sini. Sebelum ini when we started this program and so on, universities were not the leaders. Universities were not the leaders. And then only yang sekarang ini baru kita panggil semua universiti untuk masuk, because of why? Because I believe that universities are supposed to be leaders ataupun educators, because kita, especially universiti awam, bertanggungjawab untuk nation building, untuk membina negara dan sebagainya. And then we also have the knowledge, we also have labs and so on, macam-macam benda yang kita boleh gunakan untuk membantu reach out to the communities, such as the rural communities and so on. Okay. Dan at the same time, kita tidak menidakkan organisasi-organisasi yang lain, contohnya Nahrim, contohnya PPJ dan sebagainya, because they are experts in their field. Memang dia expert in their field, and then so therefore untuk kali ini, untuk apa yang kita lakukan dalam JKPLPA adalah kita berganding bahu. You know, we collaborate with one another in any of the program, and Ayami wanted to actually to share with you all saying that okay, kita memang collaborate every time kita collaborate, every time kita ada program and so on. Memang bukan hanya daripada universiti tetapi also daripada organisation and so on. Now, the things that we have found bila kita nak reaching out to rural communities, the challenges are actually many. Bukan hanya masa kita nak plan for the program, we thought that we may have covered everything. Tetapi bila kita sampai waktu delivery on the hari kejadian, on the eventful day, then we found that Allahu Akbar, ada lagi macam-macam lagi yang kita ada. Antaranya yang saya boleh katakan di sini yang I can share with you is in terms of language. We had this problem. You see, I was the one masa kita pergi datang di sekolah St. Michael, contohnya pada waktu itu bertemu bual, and then kita nak deliver kita punya program and so on, language was the barrier. Because of why? Because bahasa Selangor untuk Sarawakian ataupun masa kita pergi dengan Sabahan and so on is different daripada apa yang kita biasakan di Peninsula Malaysia. And then it is our fault, not their fault, not the community's fault. It is our fault because we should be ready for that. Kita sepatutnya tahu, boleh menganggarkan bahawa perkara tersebut berlaku, and then so therefore in that language not supposed to be a barrier for us. Okay, tetapi it is, because again, sampai sekarang pun, walaupun kita dah banyak kali pergi trip, pergi ke Sabah ataupun Sarawak and so on, kita still tak boleh expert dalam bahasa-bahasa mereka and so on. So again, kadang-kadang kita terpaksa menggunakan translators and so on. Sebab sayang sangat, why? Because the communities were there actually to learn from them, from us, and then we also wanted to learn from them, because again, apabila kita guna kata reaching out to rural communities, we are not only reaching out to rural communities, but then they are actually reaching out to us. Why? Because they also have their own way, simplified methods on how they can actually menguruskan air dengan cara mereka sendiri, so on. Okay, so now cultural norm, level of knowledge, respecting differences, as I said, in terms of age, race, religion, political and so on. This one supposed to be semua kena letak ke tepi. And then of course, in terms of the local issue interest. When kita datang ke tempat orang and so on, sometimes have our own perception. We were biased because of why? Because we learn daripada apa yang kita baca, daripada secondary data, daripada information sepertinya. Not necessarily benda tu ada. Benda tu mungkin tak jadi yang seperti itu. So now when we go there, it's very very important for us to actually to not only observe, tetapi to adapt ourselves in knowing the issue. Selami terus isu tersebut before kita boleh bantu untuk deliver and so on. So ini ada gambar-gambar yang kita share yang datang daripada website apa UNESCO IHP tentang program-program di rural yang tersebut ya. And then after that now, yang tadi tu adalah tentang yang Borneo yang being led by UNIMAS. Now I wanted to share about this reaching out to rural communities dekat bahagian Peninsula Malaysia. And then the one that I am choosing to share with you is about program bersama orang asli Sungai Mas Pahang. Yang ini dikendalikan pada 2019. Lokasinya di Kampung Sungai Mas Kuantan Pahang. Itu ini merupakan perkampungan orang asli. Then we take one and a half days untuk sampaikan program tersebut. Program ini. And then kita ada dua tujuan. Seperti mana yang saya katakan tadi, you know, mula-mula kita memang kita datang sana because of kita nak bagi penerangan asas tentang peranan masyarakat orang asli supaya mereka boleh dapat berperilaku bijak dalam pengurusan air dan juga teknologi hijau. Okay. Dan juga tujuan yang kedua, ini adalah tujuan yang kita kata, bukan kata secondary, untuk kita masih lagi consider primary juga. Sebabnya kita nak menyuntik minat pelajar terhadap bidang sains dan juga teknologi. And then ini adalah untuk kisah ini, untuk grup ini, kalau kita lihat di sini, dalam kita targetkan tiga grup, community, school children dan juga teachers. And then yang 8 orang ini daripada community represent the Tok Patin and Tok Empat. Ini semuanya orang-orang yang berstatus di dalam komuniti masing-masing. And then after that, untuk yang school children, kita ada 90 pelajar daripada preschool, standard 1 to 3, and then standard 4 to 5, standard 4 to 6, dan juga special students. And then kita ada teachers daripada sekolah yang sama. Reason pasal apa kita selalunya buat di sini, kita tak pernah bagi one in one. Kita always kita punya package mesti 2-in-1 ke 3-in-1 and so on. Sebab satu, again, as I said, untuk cost, you know, it is very costly to conduct such program. Lepas tu yang kedua is very difficult for us to actually to naik untuk sama rata, bukan sama rata kan, untuk memanggil ke semua instructor-instructor yang terlibat untuk bersama-sama menjayakan program yang tersebut. So because of that, ada orang yang tak ada cuti, ada orang yang begini, ada orang begitu dan sebagainya and so on. And then of course, this one is also, kita juga jadikan juga tempat di mana kami jadikan tempat training of trainers. Dan dalam hal ini, contohnya dalam program ini, contohnya students daripada Department of Civil Engineering, Faculty of Engineering were trained to become facilitators. Why? Because kita takkan ada di sini selamanya. In terms of me, for example, in few years time, I'll be retiring. So somebody else has to actually to take up this job, this task. The responsibility is now being shared ataupun akan jatuh ke atas bahu semua yang facilitators, junior facilitators yang kita train ini. Okay. Now, again, dalam program ini contohnya walaupun kita katakan ini adalah community, okay, you can actually see here, ini adalah dia buat tentang water rockets, okay, water rockets. Cara-cara yang seperti ini akan menyebabkan student-student berminat tentang sciences and at the same time they also know macam mana dia nak buat pengurusan air and so on. And then module delivery kita gunakan secara, you know, secara santai. Kita gunakan juga video hands on dan juga games supaya mereka tak rasa terbeban, terikat di dalam classroom and so on. So dalam satu-satu hal seperti ini, contohnya kita akan educate diorang tentang water quality, creating simple clean water filter, use of solar as alternative source of energy, water cycle, forest importance, water in ibadah, solid waste management dan juga water rockets and so on. So ini adalah among the modules that kita ada. Ini seperti yang tadi kata, saya boleh go on terus. Okay, ini adalah modul-modul yang kita pecahkan kepada community. Seperti mana kita lihat di sini, dia ada 6 modul altogether. And because dia ada community and so on, so therefore air dan ibadah kita letakkan di other groups, tetapi untuk yang lain memang khas untuk community yang tersebut sahaja. Okay, now let me just quickly share with you. Ini adalah untuk yang group student, ya, group student dan juga lecturers ataupun student ataupun teachers mereka. So they also have 6 modules. Dan kalau kita lihat di sini, again, yang ada kereta solar. Tadi tak ada kereta solar kan? Tadi tak ada roket air. So now in terms of this, kita ada. And kita juga buat filter water made from waste. And also yang demo aquaponic dan sebagainya adalah something yang to show them what's going on. And because untuk yang group C ini adalah group yang paling nakal, yang mana dia melibatkan preschoolers dan juga standards students daripada standard 1-3. Jadi kita kena buat mereka supaya mereka happy and so on, as if macam mereka pergi ke tempat ke satu-satu carnival. So dalam yang ini contohnya dekat dalam aktiviti lapangan, kita buat jadi ada station 1, station 2, station 3, station 4, whereby they learn. Dia pergi jalan sana sini and so on, and but then they learn something about that. So again, they have 6 modules and so on. So as you can actually see in terms of this gambar-gambar yang kita tunjukkan, apa yang gambar-gambar yang kita share di sini, kita akan lihat bahawa kita try as much as possible face to face, and then after that memang kita secara model AIDA tadi memang diterapkan di sini, memang diterapkan di sini, attention, interest, desire, action. So that lepas pada ni mereka sendiri boleh boleh come up and do the programs themselves. And then of course kita tak melupakan juga, sebab kalau kita nak pergi ke community dan sebagainya, kita mesti make sure kata orang-orang kita being trained. And then salah satu daripadanya, kita dah ada buat training of trainers 2020 di Macam Kelantan, yang ni being led by UMT, University of Malaysia Terengganu.
Prof Nam, can I give you about 10 minutes, maybe you can wrap up? So yeah, otherwise we're going to actually exceed and there is actually another session actually coming in as well. Alright, Prof Nam, alright.
10 minutes, okay, 10.
Yeah, okay.
Alright then. Okay, dan dalam training of trainers ini, dan kita lihat mereka-mereka semuanya akan di train in terms of all those modul-modul yang kita akan sharekan di situ. And then now, tak banyak ada ayah, sikit je lagi. But now, the thing is, you have to remember, walaupun kita sentiasa menggunakan yang tadi, training of trainers, however, masalah kita sekarang ni, the real challenge yang kita buat adalah how are we going to adapt to the new norm. Masa bermula kita ada pandemic effect, dan kalau kita lihat di sini semuanya ditunda, you know, all these things and so on. Yang ini adalah the last program yang kita buat, sebelum kita ada PKP, PKP 2020. And then because of that, kita dah belajar. After that, now kita menggunakan technology. So hence the reason for why now kita bukan hanya kita punya meeting kita buat begini, tetapi all the other bengkel, the virtual bengkel and so on kita buat. Okay, in terms of this. And that's it. I'm going to wrap up. Thank you for listening and also participating in this. I really hope that UNIMAS will prosper and then continue the good effort it has started with this. And then with this, I'm just saying the best amongst us are those who benefit others. So hence the reason for why kita semua berada di dalam JKPLPA untuk memastikan bahawa ini berlaku. So hence the reason for why we are not calling ourselves as experts. We know that sentiasa memang ada orang lain yang memang expert dan memang tahu dan sebagainya. So hence the reason for why now I am telling you all, let's work together. Apa-apa saja, we are open to anything. We look forward to have you on our team. Thank you very much.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much, Prof Napsiah. So Prof Napsiah ataupun we actually fondly call her Kak Nap. It's always the energetic one, yeah, in the family, yeah. So she always bring the energy and the passion, you know. So these are actually the one that actually really, really good with school kids, with all the youngsters, yeah, that bring all this energy. All right, Kak Nap, can you unshare your slide so that I can actually pass to Dr. Rosmina? Whilst Prof Nap actually doing, and also to pass to the next presenter, there are also a few highlights that actually addressed by Prof Nap that actually part of why we actually starting on this as a first step. We went to Barrio, we see how wonderful is the Barrio community, but like Prof Nap said also, the language and also the levels, the way that we want to actually educate the community. and also to pass on, especially on the scientific part. Yeah, that's why ECT actually having the group of experts also coming in on the language and on the education. Yeah. So the Bahru actually a really, really wonderful places for us. Yeah. So and also whenever we come in with all this, actually the logistic was actually very costly. That's why the impact and also the two have to be measured accordingly. So that's actually the standard actually being put by all those funders, yeah, working with the agency. All right. And also you know, in Sarawak, you know, and also Sabah also the same. For Sarawak, for example, we have Lembaga Sungai-Sungai Sarawak, yeah, that actually di bawah Kuasa Ordinan Sungai-Sungai Sarawak 1993, yeah. So it's actually a different jurisdiction, yeah. So there are a lot of this protocol, yeah, and also the political side, yeah. So sometimes it also actually create, you know, some challenge, yeah. But Alhamdulillah, going through step by step, yeah. So we hope, you know, when come to this, you know, it's actually for the benefit of everyone, okay. Especially for the rural community of Sarawak, UNIMAS actually, you know, being with all those, you know, PTJs, for example, like engineering, actually doing wonderful job, yeah, and have expert and so on, and we also have a lot of community work as well. So these are part of why we come together. So now, without further delay, I would like to welcome, yeah, Dr. Rosmina, our director in the Water Research Center from the Faculty of Engineering. Are you ready, Dr. Rosmina?
Yes. All right. Can you see my screen sharing?
Okay. Good to see you. So I see your screen look nicely. Okay. Pass to you, Dr. Rosmina. All right.
Thank you. So my screen is all good, yeah?
Yeah. It looks very good. Okay.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Dr. Aya, I would like to first and foremost thank the organizer for inviting me to the session. Then also to say, assalamualaikum and say good morning. Yeah, good morning, everybody. To Engineer Hajah Bibi Zarina Bidichi Omar, the first panelist, and also Professor Dr. Napsia Abdul Wahid, who was the second presenter earlier. And of course, to Associate Professor Dr. Rahaya Muhammad Noor. Thank you very much. And I'm here. My name is Rosmina Ahmad Bustami. I'm here representing UNIMAS Water Center, presenting on sustainable water for rural communities from a Sarawak point of view. So I've worked, like Dr. Rahaya has mentioned earlier, we've worked a lot with communities, whether it's for water, and also for energy, you know, providing energy to the rural communities. Right, without further ado, let's see if this works. Okay, I'm going to touch about the global, how things are going globally first before zooming into Sarawak. So, boleh pakai campur-campur kan, Dr. Raya, boleh kan? So, back in 2015, this is a bit outdated, perhaps Prof. Nap and also JBB has more recent data. 2.1 billion people globally lack safe water at home. So it's not only an issue here locally, but also a worldwide issue. And UNICEF has set a mission of you know, providing universal and equitable access to safe water for all by 2030. We still have 150 million global citizens drinking water directly from surface sources such as streams and lakes. And about 4.5 billion people globally have no toilets at home that safely manage their water. All right, and about 600 million others share toilet or latrine with other households. Now, what about Sarawak? I noticed that Hajah Bibi and also, you know, Prof. Naps, yeah, the first two speakers come from, you know, a good point of view, but I'm going to, this actually gives me the advantage of talking about what's happening here locally. I understand that they have vast experience overseas, and, you know, that would be a good addition to what we can do in the future for the state. All right, 99.8% of urban community, orang tinggal di city, urban, are connected to water supply, the grid. About only 66.5% of our communities in the rural are connected to the state water supply grid juga. So in total, about 83.4% of our residents, yang semua orang yang tinggal di Sarawak are connected to water supply. Okay, so they have access to water supply. Not that bad. Okay, and under the Sarawak Water Authority, there are three ministries governing different sectors. The first one is Ministry of Utilities Sarawak, which was introduced, I think, back in 2015, 16, 17, just recently. And the arm looking into the Sarawak Water is the Sarawak Water Authorities, SWA. And there are four agencies responsible for water supply throughout the state. The first is the Rural Water Supply Department, JBAP, looking into rural water supply development in the state. And we have Kuching Water Board, responsible for the southern region, Cebu Water Board, SWB for the central region, and Laku Management Sdn Bhd, a GLC company looking after the northern region, Bintulu, Limbang, and Miri. And we also have the State Ministry of Urban Development and Natural Resources, where we have Natural Resources and Environment Board, and also Ministry of Local Government and Housing Sarawak looking into the sewerage and also irrigation and drainage. So these are the governing bodies of waters in Sarawak. State's vision, Sarawak State vision is to have 100% utilities coverage in Sarawak by 2025. That's about 4 years from now. This includes the digitalization, public-private partnership, resiliency of system in high level of services are expected. So, but we don't want to leave anyone behind. So among the challenges yang kita ada ialah tekanan air, okay, water storage in development and communities. Kita make sure that, you know, ada satu hari capacity, and we want to make sure that untuk 100% ini nanti plant reserve margin ialah pada tahap 20% setiap masa, 20% plant reserve margin at all times. And when the government has put up strategies in place to manage the water development in the state, there are short-term solutions, rancangan jangka pendek, medium-term solutions, and also rancangan jangka panjang, long-term solutions, which include digitalization, modernization of the plants, and also connection to the water grid. Now, Sarawak has a very challenging topography. It's the biggest state in Malaysia. It's in the tropics, ada gunung, ganang, gaung, semua ada. So the topography is very challenging. So at the moment, we have about 92 water treatment plants with a total capacity of 1,637 milliliters per day, and the demand which exceeds that capacity slightly. And unfortunately, the non-irrigated water is, you know, quite high, okay, average, but the state is looking at lowering this number down from 40% to about 25%. They're about 609,000 water meters and 29 gazetted water catchment areas. All right, so that's the water supply, overall water supply outlook of Sarawak. And for SAWAS, which is Sarawak Alternative Water Supply System, because we can't all the time, because of the challenging topography. And some of these communities live in very rural areas, and it's not possible to connect them to the water grid. Not always possible to connect them to the water grid. Some of the options that the state is offering, it's not we, this is the state, which is offering, is the fuel packages of Sarawak Alternative Water Supply, right? And the yellow dots here are from gravity feed, rainwater, and also we have some rainwater intake as well. Okay. These are some of the ongoing projects at the moment under JBAP. We can see that there are the installation of main pipe connected from Sarawak water grid in Long Lamai Miri South Project at Nangga Bau in Dalat, improvement of water supply infrastructure and distribution system, a new water treatment plant, water grid projects, improvement water supply system in Pulau Berit in Muka, high impact water supply projects in Sirian, water supply infrastructure and distribution system in Northern Sarawak, and 56 alternative water supply projects to be built throughout the state in 2020 to 2021. So ada banyak yang activity that is ongoing to achieve the 100% coverage of water supply in 2025. And we see this as coming in quite handsomely, achievable. And like what Dato' Engineer Alice Jawan Empaling, the Permanent Secretary of Ministry of Utilities Sarawak, has mentioned, no man, woman, and child should ever have to carry a pail of water from the river. If we talk about water sustainability, we talk about water and society. And data from the UNESCO as well, women and children are usually the ones carrying spill of water to their household from the nearby river or groundwater ataupun pergi telaga. So women and children are usually the ones carrying them, not the men, because perhaps the men pergi buat kerja kampung ke kerja luar and whatnot. So the women and children are the one manning after the house. So among the challenges that we kita foresee are insufficient water capacity. Kita tahu there are insufficient raw water sources. Sekarang ini ada high non-revenue water and also poor connectivity untuk sampai ke rural areas. All right? And that's where UNIMAS came in. And not only UNIMAS, the state has a lot of plans and projects ongoing to achieve yang inilah, that UNIMAS, our kepakaran, ialah menggunakan water ultrafiltration system. And we've installed a few of this. I'll walk you through. I hope the video works later. And we help the community, especially at rural areas. And this video doesn't work, does it, Dr. Raya?
Yeah, I think it's actually not working.
Okay.
Can you try one more time?
I've tried it earlier. I don't think it's working either. So we'll just let it be. Okay. This video actually shows the many projects that we've established. The UNIMAS, the UC itself, our Faculty of Engineering, and UNIMAS Water Center, we aim to deliver. We have a track record of successful sustainable water treatment projects, and we are confident of our proven technology and with our team of dedicated personnel. Actually, dalam video ni, you akan tengok ada orang dalam, some of our lecturers are inside the river, make sure that everything works perfectly. And we are here to contribute to achieving Sarawak's vision of 100% water supply coverage by 2025. Like we always say, no one is left behind. Some of our successful in ultra filtration water projects are in Kampung Pepat Saratok, Rumah Senabung in Selangau, SMK Ulu Balingan in Selangau, SMK Balih in Kapit, and soon there will be 10 other schools who will be benefited in this project in collaboration with Ministry of Education Malaysia, and also recently with Jabatan Pelajaran Negeri Sarawak. So we are part of this. 10 confirmed schools and 10 more. We're still looking at the feasibility and possibility of having this system installed in the schools. In working with challenging environments such as saline water, so it's not only river water, because this is where we tap the river, filter the water, and supply it to the schools or to the nearby communities. We have technologies, I think Hajar Bibi mentioned earlier. Desalination is very expensive, a desalination plant will cost billions. It's boleh dibuat tetapi very expensive. But we have an expert in the USC, an expert team in the USC, who can work with challenging environments such as the land water. We have provided treated water solutions to one of the project sites in Sadong Jaya and also Kampung Kuala Kari in Kelantan. And soon there'll be projects, other projects underway, inshallah, in Kampung Matang Terap, Puku, Kampung Selarat, and Kampung Sekambal Melayu. All of these projects are situated in Lindu. Besides that, our team of experts have also been called up to conduct water treatment studies to develop sustainable water treatment process for projects in Cebu and also Sepangan. The not only in Sarawak, but we do projects elsewhere as well in Malaysia. And other than that, UNIMAS is very, very proud to play a role in the water digitalization project, and in line with the State Digital Economic Blueprint 2018 to 2022, and realizing the Sarawak digitalization dream. If you remember, one of the long-term projects of the state is to digitalize the water supply coverage. Yeah. And our very own faculty of computer science and IT, of which ICT is closely related with, contributed in building the Jabatan Bekalan Air Luar Bandar, JBAP Command Center and Digitalization Project. This is a server room. The picture you're looking at is our is located in the server room, where you can see our Vice Chancellor on and also Director of JBAP, and also the map of daily total production, daily total energy, and total water treatment plan online, which they can monitor from the server room. All right. The objective of the project is part of the digitalization exercise by JBAP to leverage on the state-of-the-art technology, including SCADA monitoring system, monitoring, planning, to increase the efficiency and productivity of JBAP operations monitoring and planning, which includes aspect of water production, distribution, and consumption. This project is expected to be fully completed and operational by the end of this year, December 2021. So ladies and gentlemen, I think we are here to work for working together for their future. Untuk masa depan mereka yang lebih cerah, equality, kebersamaan, kesamarataan dengan semua, sama ada di bandar ataupun di luar bandar. And in UNIMAS, all of us, not only Faculty of Engineering, not only Faculty of Computer Science and Information Technology, but we work together with the like of Dr. Raya from Faculty of Science, Social, Faculty of Economics, dan juga Faculty of Medical Health and Sciences, dengan Dr. Perubatan, untuk sama-sama, looking into the well-being of our friends and families in the rural areas. I think that will be it from me, Dr. Aya.
All right, thank you very much, Dr. Rosmina. It's a very, very, what you call this, interesting updates, yeah? And in much of it, we're also not aware, even we are actually in within campus, yeah? So this is actually a really great opportunity and also to integrate in whatever we can, yeah? Like what you call Prof. Nam say just now, the best among us are those who benefit others, yeah? Yeah, I think that's yes. That's the best part when you coming in the rural community, yeah? And then when we make commitment for that. And I think, can I call, Yang Berbahagia Hajah Bibi, are you there, Hajah? Yang Berbahagia Hajah Bibi, are you there? Dah balik daripada court ke, Hajah? There is actually one question, and I think this question actually should be answered. NASA, is Yang Berbahagia Hajah Bibi is already there? NASA? Okay, I think there's...
Let me check. Okay. Let me check with her.
Kalau tak ada, tak apa. Just to make sure, there's actually one question. Kalau tak ada, kita bagi dekat NASA sajalah ya, NASA. Adakah NASA?
Dia belum bala WhatsApp.
Okay,
maybe you can give the question. Kak Nak pun mungkin boleh jawab lah.
Yang ni Kak Nasa lah ke? Kalau Nasa boleh represent the JPS ya. So, okay, this is a very quick question. We take one sajalah. The rest tu kita akan sampaikan yang ni ya. From Valerie, thank you very much Valerie for listening ya. So Nasa, the soalannya adalah ya, the question how far is rubbish and waste disposal is issue that affect your work. So we're talking from water kan sekarang kan. Security water and now there is actually a connection about waste disposal dengan rubbish ya. So Nasa mungkin boleh bagi sedikit respon daripada JPS sendiri ya tentang isu berkaitan dengan waste disposal ini dengan juga air. You know, we know that it's part of the pollution ya. So apa Nasa boleh bagi sedikit statement Nasa?
Right, thank you. Thank you Dr. Aya. Actually memang dah cakap sampah dan waste disposal ni memang main lah perkara yang utama yang telah menyebabkan satu yang seperti yang KSU cakap semalam lah, saya dapat dengar dia pergi ke Mekah, contoh satu jawapan daripada dia pergi ke Mekah and then dia diberitahu bahawa jika kita pernah dengar bahawa Mekah pernah banjir pada tiba-tiba banjir pada tahun 2014, banjir yang tiba-tiba di Bandar Mekah. The main yang pihak berkuasa cakap sana adalah sampah telah menyekat saluran-saluran di sekitar Mekah tu, padahal hujan yang dikatakan hujan di Malaysia ni lagi lebat daripada di Mekah kan, seperti yang kita tahu. Tapi sampah-sampah tu semua telah menyekat saluran-saluran longkang di sekitar Mekah dan menyebabkan banjir. Itu ada salah satu inspirasi yang kita dapat tahu bahawa sampah ini dan waste disposal ni amat menjadi perkara yang utama sekali untuk berlaku jika lebih kepada banjir lah. Yang menyebabkan itulah actually JPS yang telah memberi kesedaran, kita telah melakukan pelbagai inisiatif lah. Kita telah, seperti setiap hujung minggu sekarang kita akan turun ke sungai-sungai, kita panggil sebagai sungai angkat untuk melakukan aktiviti kudah, iaitu mengutip sampah sambil beriadah. I hope kita semua boleh lakukan itu semua dan terus kepada masyarakat lah. Itu Kak Ya.
Alright. Alright, thank you very much ya Nasa. I think that's actually the solid answer that very good ya to just wrap up our session so that we can give away to the next workshop session. I think the Miri Council also already there with the team ya. So one of the thing that that our project actually giving focus ya is actually we taking a very special interest on the rural community. Then you have seen ya in this workshop that all various agencies are representing UNIMAS. I work in UNIMAS, but UNIMAS collaborate, and also we have a lot of PTJs actually going on, yeah. And of course in education we're reaching the grassroots, yeah. So we have scientists and the experts, you know, like Dr. Rosmina and team actually going for the filtration, you know, those technological base that actually very crucial. And then we also realize that, you know, whatever technology that actually, you know, being work actually, or whatever model approach actually workable outside is actually not going to be the same, yeah, the impact in Sarawak, for example. So that's why the local issues actually becoming one of the concern, yeah, and one of the highlight of the importance when we try to design whatever approach, yeah, for UNESCO HP Malaysia and Narakan Agency like Haja Bibi and also NASA and also Kak Nap already actually explained to you, and also part of UNIMAS be doing intervention design, yeah, the way that we involve community. So we realize all those factors, yeah. And I think one of the concern also about the waste disposal, thank you Valeria, yes. I think kita tengok banyak ya kawasan-kawasan luar bandar menjadi spot ya for tourism, ya. Then we see a lot of plastic and so on, ya. And then kita pun menjadi kerisauan, ya, especially those yang tidak terima the what you call, tidak terima benefits lagi, ya, tentang the what you call treated water, ya. Macam Dr. Rosmina explain, ya, kita ada lagi portion, ya. So hopefully bengkel ini mencapailah matlamat kita, dan saya berterima kasih kepada semua panelis and also on behalf of ours UNESCO IHP Malaysia and also part of the funder daripada SCUM and also part of all the panelis, kita nak congratulate all those you know from ECT and team Prof Hanara, Prof Roger and all the team for this very very successful event, and we thankful for this session that actually invited us to be part of this panel. All right, Prof Nara, Prof Roger, I think I will wrap up. That's actually my last, and I will pass back to Prof Roger maybe. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you.